More than one-fifth of American adults suffer from chronic pain. For decades, modern medicine has tried to address this with opioids and other interventions that often don't work, or in the case of opioids, actually make the problem worse. In his new book, It Doesn't Have to Hurt, Dr. Sanjay Gupta gets to the root of chronic pain. He's a neurosurgeon and CNN's chief medical correspondent. He joins me now. Always a pleasure.
Such an honor to be here. Thank you for having me.
So to me, the most fascinating part about the general way you think about this is you point out that Americans are 4% of the world's population and consume, what, 90% of the world's opioids?
That's right. So, some of the things like Vicodin and Percocet, the numbers have changed a bit, but there was a point where we were taking 90% of those medications. We were also performing a lot of surgery. And to give you context, I found this fascinating. 1.2 million spinal operations, most of those done for pain. And to give you context, Great Britain performed 50,000. They're about a quarter of our population, but even if you do that math, right, we're still 5 to 10 times greater in terms of invasive procedures and invasive medications.
What does this tell you about pain? Is it something that we actually have much greater ability to bear or not bear it based on the culture, the expectations, the system?
I think, you know, look, we're all humans, so we all have the same physiology, similar pain tolerance overall across societies. I think this gets to cultural expectations and this idea that I really struggled with a bit in the book, but expectations and experience are inextricably linked. If you think something is going to hurt, it's probably going to hurt no matter what. And if you think it's not going to hurt, or if you don't need pain meds or a procedure, then you can do almost anything within reason to the human body, and you really don't need those medications, which I found really interesting.
So it's really, I mean, so there's a very powerful sense in which the pain is in your head.
Yeah, yes is the answer. And the reason I hesitate is because I get criticized for saying this, as have other people. You're just saying it's in my head. You're saying I'm making it up, I'm malingering. It's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that the brain is the ultimate decider of whether or not you have pain. There's these receptors in your periphery that will send signals to the brain, and the brain is then trying to make sense of it. And it's trying to make sense of the insult that you've just experienced, but also, are you depressed? Do you have anxiety? Is there an adverse childhood experience? Did you experience something like this in the past? And if so, what happened at that point? All these things sort of get commingled, then the brain has to make a decision as to how much this hurts, if at all.
Since I have you, I gotta ask you about what's going on in the news. To me, the interesting question is not, is Robert Kennedy stripping the CDC of some of its most important experts and politicizing it? It seems obvious he's doing that. But is there a kernel of truth, or maybe a more than a kernel of truth, to his critique when he says, and he lays out in an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal, that, you know, the CDC started as an infectious disease fighting outfit, it then grew, it's taken on all these other roles as mission creep. It can't do a lot of the things it used to do very well because it's lost some of that flexibility. It doesn't know what its mission is. You know, Michael Lewis talked about this, about the CDC kind of observing COVID rather than really asking itself, is it meant to fight it? So is there a value, is there a kernel of truth, and is there a value to what he's doing?
Look, I don't think there's a lot of value to the way that he's approaching it, even if there is a kernel of truth in what he's saying. Look, CDC started off as a malaria control organization, and this is in the 1940s. I think it was called the Center for Communicable Diseases at that point. I think, as happened in many places around the world, chronic diseases became the primary driver of illness and death. So the idea that you would pivot to say, hey, look, we got to talk about cardiac disease, we got to talk about cancer, diabetes, and even dementia, that became under the purview of the CDC. Where I think he has a point is that that just sort of happened. And still the Centers for Disease Control, they add and prevention at some point. But I don't think the mission was as clear. And I think we probably had a hard time with this during COVID because the focus on infectious diseases wasn't as great as it once was. So yeah, we have to be talking about these other things, Fareed. I mean, you know, if you look at cardiac disease, it is still the biggest killer in this country. What organization is gonna oversee that? Right. And you know, the irony, I think, with RFK is that he talks about MAHA, making America healthy again, and I think everyone agrees with that. And they agree that the United States is not very healthy. But how is he going to do it? So far, if you look objectively, measurably at what he's done, it's been a focus on seed oils and food dyes. How is that getting us to where we need to be? I mean, I think it's very concerning, and I don't want to be hyperbolic about this, but, you know, I'm a doctor, and I think that our healthcare system has been really damaged by what has happened over the last year. Really damaged. We've lost brain talent. People are going to other countries. The United States is not viewed as sort of that leader in healthcare, I think, in many places around the world. And I think we're going to feel that impact for a long time to come.
Sanjay Gupta, the book is really fascinating, and I have not finished it, but I'd strongly recommend it to everyone. Thank you.
Such a pleasure, Fareed. Thank you.